First letter to the Corinthians. Do you not know that a little yeast leavens the whole batch of dough? Clean out the old yeast so that you may be a new batch, as you really are unleavened. For our Paschal Lamb, Christ, has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us celebrate the festival, not with the old yeast, the yeast of malice and evil, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Welcome to back to St. Andrew's Chapel and happy Easter. Some time ago, when I was in England, I was invited to a fancy dinner party where I had to send in a biography that said a little bit about me so that they could know who to place me next to and so that we could have something to talk about. And I included the fact that at that time I was coaching a college rowing team. So when I arrived before dinner, there was a time for cocktails, and a man came over to me and asked me about my rowing career. The book, The Boys in the Boat, had just been published about the 1936 Washington team that competed in Nazi Germany, and he asked me if I'd read it, and we had a polite conversation. I assumed that he knew nothing about rowing, and so I was fairly dismissive and moved past the conversation quickly. When the time came to be seated for dinner, it turned out that this very man was seated to my left, but I began by talking to the person to my right. And in quick order, he said, "Oh, are you the rower?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, have you met Tim Foster, the man to your left?" And I said, "Yes, we just had a conversation at cocktails before dinner." And the man said, "Well, did you know that Tim is an Olympic gold medalist?" And I looked at him, I said, "Really? In what sport?" And he said, "In rowing." And it was one of those moments where I gulped, and I felt like I was going to have to pull the shoe that was firmly wedged in between my teeth out of my mouth. And I was thinking back to everything that I had said before dinner, thinking, how much of a fool did I make of myself in that moment? Of course, he'd been opening the door for me perhaps to ask him about his life or his rowing career, and I completely whiffed. Surely, some of you have had a moment like that where you learn something new about somebody or something in your life, and it makes you stop and reconsider everything that's come before it. This is a literary motif of sorts. I think of the character Snape in the Harry Potter series, who we think is the villain all the way through into the last book when you realize that everything he had ever done was actually fighting for the good. This is the kind of moment that Jesus' resurrection prompts in his disciples. Having moved through death and returned from the dead, everybody has to stop and reconsider everything that they thought they knew, not just about Jesus, but about the world. And all those things that Jesus said, all the way back at the beginning of his ministry, you shall destroy this temple and I will raise it in 3 days. Everybody thought he'd been talking about the bricks and mortar in Jerusalem, but now they see he was talking about his body. From the very beginning, Jesus knew that he was going to die and knew that he was going to be resurrected to show the world that we do not have to fear death. And that's the first thing that Jesus tells to his disciples. First, the angel who comes back and talks to Mary Magdalene and Mary at the tomb says, "Do not be afraid." The first words to them after the resurrection. And running from the tomb to share this good news with the disciples, Jesus appears to them on the way, and his first words are greetings. Do not be afraid. Dr. Halsey, in his very first address to the student body this year, providentially and perhaps prophetically, quoted the Irish poet John O'Donohue, who said that the phrase, "do not be afraid," appears 357 times in the Bible, one for every day of the year and a leap year. I'm not sure that that's scripturally accurate, but I think it's true. Do not be afraid. Of course, the first thing that Adam and Eve experience after they eat of the fruit of the tree of knowledge and good and evil in the garden of evil is fear. They look down, they see that they are naked, and they are afraid. Do not be afraid, God says to Cain, when he sees that God favors Abel's offering before he murders him. Do not be afraid, Abraham says to Isaac, the Lord will provide. Do not be afraid, God tells the Israelites as they are fleeing Pharaoh's army and they're watching him bear down upon them. Do not be afraid, because fear is a synonym for our sin. And we are awash in a culture of fear. This is nothing new. From time immemorial, politicians and those in power have stoked fears to use it for their own advantage. Corporations and merchants have manufactured fears so that they can sell us things to protect us from the very fears that they manufacture. News outlets and media exaggerate fears systemically to improve their ratings. But interestingly, in this modern era, an author, Frank Furedi, pointed out in his book, A Culture of the Fear, we have paradoxically become so good at eliminating the sources of danger. That has become really the only way we know how to handle fear. And so when something like COVID-19 comes along, something that is so surprising and so out of the blue and so out of our control, it catches us completely by surprise. That's the scariest thing about this pandemic, after all. It's not that we could get sick. It's not that some people could die. It's that we had no idea that it was coming. We are planning our lives as usual, and then out of nowhere, we see that we don't actually have the kind of control over our lives that we thought we had. We do everything in our power to try and pretend that we are in control. But in the final analysis, the human condition is one that is leading towards a state of being beyond which we cannot see, which is death. And the fear of death drives so much in our lives. In American culture, we do everything we can to forget that death is a reality. If you're not young and remarkably good-looking, you probably don't make your way onto TV. Or if you're old and remarkably young and good-looking, you might get on TV. We have this myth that 25 is somehow the peak of our lives and that 30 is a tragedy because we want to push off that time in our lives where we have to confront the unknown. But Jesus, in his death and resurrection, shows us a different way to handle our fear and sin, which is not to eliminate it. Jesus doesn't stop death. He lives it. He walks right through it. He gets to the other side and he beckons us through and says, "Follow me. There is more to life than just death." It's okay to experience fear when a pandemic comes upon us. And it's good to try and diminish the sources of danger. We should do everything in our power to protect ourselves and others so that this pandemic doesn't spread. But that core existential fear of not being in control is something that we can live with, live in spite of. We can conquer that fear by living with it. And that's a muscle that I fear is underdeveloped in our society. And Jesus goes right at that. He says, this thing, death, yes, it's scary, but you can live with it and through it and come out on the other side, resurrected. We do not need to fear even death itself. That is the good news of Easter. And that is the opportunity that every Woodbury boy currently has. Particularly you seniors who thought that your senior spring would play out just as it has for the past 130 years. And guess what? Life happened. We're not in control. And that's scary, and it's disappointing, and it's saddening, and it's angry. But in the light of the resurrection, we are given the promise that you can live through it and with it and come out on the other end resurrected with new life and better life. And that's how Jesus asks us to look at the world through the light of his resurrection, that no matter how bad things get, no matter how scary they become, we know that we can live with it and live through it and come out on the other side, saying, "Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia."
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for this gathering, and for all ministers and people. Pray for the church. We ask your prayers for peace, goodwill among nations, and for well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace. I ask your prayers for all those who are suffering from COVID-19. Pray for mercy. I ask your prayers for the staff members of the Food Services Department and golf course crew at Woodbury Forest School. Pray for their safekeeping and good fortune. I ask your prayers for the departed, particularly Mr. Daniel W. Banner, class of 1973, and Marjorie Mills, Mr. Mills' grandmother, who passed away Friday at the age of 97. We also pray for those who have died from COVID-19. Pray for the departed. Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people, and strengthen us to do your will. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.